We'll resume the meeting. Members, do we have any more comments on the administration's response? If not, we'll resume the clause-by-clause examination. We were at page 33 of the martyr copy, that is clause 10 of the bill. Thank you, Chair. We were at page 33 of the martyr copy, schedule 2 of chapter 545. We have no amendments for paragraph 1. For paragraph 2, that is page 34 of the martyr copy, as said earlier, for applications involving two or more lots, when determining the reserve price, the tribunal should take into account the joint redevelopment potential of the lots on their own, which is why we are amending paragraph 2. Because at the moment, paragraph 2 would only take into account the redevelopment potential of the lot on its own, where two or more lots are the subject of the auction on their own. We have now provided for the two different scenarios for the new paragraph A. It would say, which takes into account, one, for an order for sale of one lot, the redevelopment potential of the lot on its own, or two, for an order for sale of two or more lots, the joint redevelopment potential of the lots on their own. End. So we have made such amendments so that the Lands Tribunal would take into account the joint redevelopment potential when determining the reserve price. The Assistant Legal Advisor asked that when determining the reserve price, whether the tribunal would have the discretion to consider other matters apart from the redevelopment potential. To which we would say that for two or more lots, the Lands Tribunal would have to consider the joint redevelopment potential. That's why, because we have provided for that, there is no need for the Lands Tribunal to consider other matters. Page 35 of the martyr copy for Schedule 3 of Chapter 545. Conditions to which purchaser of lot and purchaser successors in title shall be subject. We have made sure that section 9 would become a land lease condition. And what will the condition be, you may ask? It is said that within 6 years, the purchaser of the lot would have to redevelop the lot. That is what we have in existing provisions of Schedule 3. During the consultations, we received feedback on this. For joint redevelopment of lots, the developer may need to have lot extension or in situ land exchange performed. But because the period would expire after 6 years, if the purchaser has to perform in-situ land exchange, they would first have to apply to the Lands Tribunal to make sure the period would be made applicable to the new lot. Essentially, the restriction would have to be transferred from the original lot to the new lot, and then the purchaser would have to apply to the lands department for a lot extension or an in situ land exchange. We wish to streamline the procedures, so we have amended Schedule 3 to say that the purchaser would not have to make an advance application to Lands Tribunal. Well, before we talk about paragraphs 2 and 3, we talked about how the administration would consider extending the period from 6 years to 7 years, correct? Yes, we will talk about that during our proposed CSAs. Now I'll read out verbatim paragraphs 2 and 3. Paragraph 2, Section 1 of this schedule extends to a new lot, whether or not a new lot number assigned that is granted by or on behalf of the government in a lot extension or in situ land exchange application involving the lot mentioned in that section and any other lots, if any. It is as I said earlier, if for a single lot, it has to go through a lot extension or an in situ land exchange application, the 6-year period would be made applicable to the new lot. So this is our policy intent. For paragraph 3, we have provided more details. That is, if there is more than one period as described in Section 1 of this schedule applying to a new lot, that is, an order of sale is made applicable to the new lot, and when there are multiple orders for sale, the periods would have different expiration deadlines. How will the period, that is the end of the period, be determined? We would adopt the earliest end date of the order for sale. So we have provided for such in paragraph 3. I'll now read out the paragraph verbatim. If there is more than one period as described in Section 1 of this schedule applying to the new lot by the operation of Section 2 of this schedule, the time frame for the redevelopment of the new lot is the period with the earliest end date of such other period as may be allowed by the tribunal on the application of the owner of the new lot. So this reflects our policy intent in the sense that if there are 3 orders for sale, we would adopt the period with the earliest end date or such other period as may be allowed by the tribunal. Mr. Lewis Long, excuse me. I understand the contents of the 2 paragraphs. I want to ask about paragraph 3 in particular. Why is it that the period with the earliest end date would be adopted instead of the latest end date? What are the justifications of the administration? Thank you, Mr. Lewis Loan. We want to make sure redevelopment is completed as soon as possible, which is why when there are more than 1 lot, we would want the redevelopment of the relevant lots be completed as soon as possible, which is why we would adopt the period with the earliest end date. If that is not possible, we would provide for the scenario that the developer can apply to the Lands Tribunal to extend the period.
我可以接受。
Well, this is acceptable to me. I guess there isn't a significant difference between the two. Well, theoretically speaking, if there is a later end date with two lots combined, then the work involved will be more complicated. That's why you opt for the later end date. But if you opt for the earliest end date, and by doing this you want to send out the message that you want to complete the relevant procedure ASAP, then I guess this is acceptable. We have proposed a CSA on this. There's a small revision proposed to make the relevant provision more clear. After the passage of the bill, well, there are provisions stipulating how applications will be dealt with for those submitted before or after the commencement date of the bill. We want people to be able to make use of Schedule 3 to the ordinance after the passage of the bill, so that the lots concerned can be dealt with through the streamlined procedure. Please carry on. We've finished the clause-by-clause scrutiny of Cap 545. We now move on to Cap 545A. All the amendments are about the revised threshold and the proposed designated area. Page 36 of the marked-up copy, there is a small amendment to the interpretation. We removed the interpretation for occupation permit and relevant date because these two interpretations have been included in Cap 545. We're adding a new interpretation or definition for the term designated area. This is because we are introducing through this bill the concept of designated area. And a designated area means an area set out in the schedule. Page 37. Specification of percentage. It stipulates that applicants will have to comply with certain requirements when submitting a compulsory sale application. Currently, there is only one specified percentage, that's 80%. In the future, there will be three different percentages: 80%, 70%, and 65%. That's why we have to add 70% and 65%, the new two thresholds under Section 3. So there are subsections 1, 2, and 3 under Section 3 here. Under subsection 1, the phrase "a class of lots specified in Section 4, bracket 1" is added. There is a newly added subsection 2 as well. It says that 70% is specified as the percentage required for the purpose of Section 3, bracket 1 of the ordinance. There is also a newly added subsection 3. It says that 65% is specified as the percentage required for the purposes of Section 3, bracket 1 of the ordinance in respect of a lot that belongs to a class of lots specified in Section 4, bracket 3. So two new thresholds are added here. They are 70% and 65%. Section 4, specification of classes of lots. It talks about what kind of lots apply to the three respective thresholds mentioned above. Section 4, subsection 1, for the purposes of Section 3, bracket 1, the class of lots is A, a lot with each of the units on the lot representing more than 10% of all the undivided shares in the lot. We have this class of lots in the existing arrangement. On the left-hand side, you see the proposed part of the existing bill that is that should be removed. And you see that under the existing arrangement, for lots with no more than 10% of the undivided shares, then the threshold of 80% would apply. So this arrangement remains unchanged. We've added part B here. It talks about what kind of lots fall within the 80% threshold. A lot that is not located within a designated area and with each of the buildings erected on the lot issued with an occupation permit at least 50 years but less than 60 years before the relevant date. Our proposal that if a lot is situated in a non-designated area and the building is aged 50 years or above but less than 60 years old, then the threshold for compulsory sale would be 80%. So this part is for the 80% threshold. Now section 4 subsection 2, it's about the 70% threshold. For the purposes of section 3, bracket 2, the class of lots is A, a lot that is located within a designated area, and with each of the buildings erected on the lot issued with an occupation permit at least 50 years, but less than 60 years before the relevant date. So this applies to buildings aged about 50 years, but below 60 years old within a designated area. B, a lot that is not located within a designated area and with each of the buildings erected on the lot issued with an occupation permit at least 60 years but less than 70 years before the relevant date. So this applies to buildings aged 60 years or above but less than 70 years within a designated within a non-designated area. C, a lot that is not located within an industrial zone and each of the buildings erected on the lot 1 is an industrial building and 2 was issued with an occupation permit at least 30 years before the relevant date. Currently, we impose a lower threshold for buildings that are located in non-industrial zones with a building age of less than 30 years. And the threshold is 80% to 80%. So in order to speed up redevelopment of buildings aged 30 years or above in non-industrial zone, we're lowering the threshold from 80% to 70%. I'd want to see clarification on one point. In the past, there were no cases in which multiple or adjoining lots were involved. And in order to apply for compulsory sale, well, there must be buildings erected on the lots concerned. Now you're allowing applications involving adjoining lots. Say one of the lots is left idle. That means no buildings are erected on the lot. Now, under section 4, subsection 2 proposed here, it says an occupation permit will have to be issued within a specified date. C, say a building has already been demolished, but before it is demolished, an occupation permit was issued. Does that apply? Yes. Ms. Carmen Khan, I have a question about subsection 2B. I've got quite a number of views about buildings located within non-designated area that are older than 60 years old, but less than 70 years of age for the threshold. So for the threshold between designated area and non-designated area, the difference of the threshold is only 5%. Some are of the view that there is not enough incentive for buildings in designated areas to be redeveloped because the difference between designated areas and non-designated areas is only 5% in terms of the threshold. Also, there were discussions about how buildings or areas are listed as designated areas. And for some of the buildings, the difference in the threshold between the two types of areas is 10%. I think the administration will have to explain to the general public about the policy intent, and you'll have to keep in view of people's feedback about the ordinance after the bill is passed. You may want to adjust the thresholds in accordance with people's views. We will come to the part where the administration will be given power to revise the list of designated areas. When you consider adding more places to designated areas, you may have to take into account different factors. Page 39 of the marked up copy, section 4, subsection 3. Here the threshold is 65%. For the purpose of section 3, bracket 3, the class of lots is a lot that is located within a designated area and with each of the buildings erected on the lot issued with an occupation permit at least 60 years but less than 70 years before the relevant date, or B, a lot with each of the buildings erected on the lot issued with an occupation permit at least 70 years before the relevant date. Subsection 4. There are certain types of buildings with the threshold of 80%. Subsection 4A exists in the prevailing legislation. For the purposes of the class of lots referred to in subsection 1A, A, if a unit in a building is subdivided into two or more units on or after the 1st of April 2010, and the subdivision does not involve 1. Any alteration to the size of any common area of the building, or 2. Any change in person's liability in relation to the common areas and facilities of the building under the common law or any enactment, those units are to be regarded as one single unit. As mentioned, if the undivided shares of each of the units is over 10%, then the threshold is 80%. A few years ago, when we amended the ordinance, we created this category because we thought there might be cases where people abused the legislation. For some minority owners, they want to avoid compulsory sale, and if each of the property they own account for more than 10% of the undivided shares, then such situation would fall within the 80% threshold. Say for an owner, he may divide the 16% undivided share of a property into two, then each unit will account for 8% of the undivided share, and in that case, it would not fall within the 80% of threshold. We want to avoid such situations, therefore, we introduced this subsection 4A to prevent people from dividing a unit into two or more units. To avoid having their units falling within the 80% threshold.
We are amending the legislation because we have already prevented people from altering the size of any common area of the building, but we have not prevented them from amalgamating the units. If they amalgamate the units, they may obtain more undivided shares, thus meeting the threshold. So we want to be more comprehensive, so we have added B to section 4. If two or more units in a building are amalgamated into one single unit on or after the specified date, the amalgamation would be subject, the amalgamated unit would be subject to the 80% threshold. Let me read out the part verbatim. If two or more units in a building are amalgamated into one single unit on or after the specified date, and the amalgamation does not involve one, any alteration to the size of any common area of the building, or any change in a person's liability in relation to the common areas and facilities of the building under the common law or any enactment, those units are being amalgamated are to be regarded as separate units. So we want to prevent abuse by amalgamation of units. Next, in this section, specified date means the date on which the land compulsory sale for redevelopment amendment ordinance 2023 blank of 2023 comes into operation. That is the commencement date of the bill. We have also added part 5, section 5, amendment of schedule. That is the Secretary for Development may by notice published in the Gazette amend the schedule. We have added a schedule after this. The schedule will set out what the designated areas are. So one or areas included in Sai Ying Pun and Shen Guan outline zoning plan number S/H3/34. 2. All areas included in Wenchai outline zoning plan number S/H5/31. 3. All areas included in Yamate outline zoning plan number S/K2/24. 4. All areas included in Mongkok outline zoning plan number S/K3/36. 5. All areas included in Changshawan outline zoning plan number S/K5/39. 6. All areas included in Mataukot outline zoning plan number S/K10/30. 7. All areas included in Chunwen outline zoning plan number S/TW/35. Ms. Common Khan. Chair. I believe in our previous discussions, regarding designated areas, the administration said with amendments, it's not just with the addition of designated areas, it would also include deletion of designated areas from the schedule. So if the developer has already acquired some properties, will the administration delete the relevant areas from the schedule of designated areas? Also, with the amendment, what is the meaning of it? Do we make use of the dictionary meaning, or is there a definition in Chapter 1 interpretations and general clauses ordinance? I also want to ask, what factors will the administration consider when amending the schedule? Thank you. We would make use of the ordinary meaning for the word amendment, and that would include both addition and deletion. As for the factors we would consider when setting designated areas, as we discussed in detail before, we would consider the age of buildings, that is, how many buildings in the area are age 50 or above, and the number of buildings in the area issued with notices under the Mandatory Building Inspection Scheme, MBIS. We may consider other factors as well in future, should there be a change in circumstances. We consider such considerations to be administrative in nature. That's why we have not set out in the bill the factors we would consider. Well, Ms. Doreen Kong has another meeting, so on her behalf, I will ask some questions that she gave me. So for designated areas, you have provided the specific numbers for outline zoning plans. So Ms. Doreen Kong asked if the numbers are updated. If the outline zoning plans are amended, you would have the numbers amended here as well, correct? Thank you, Chair, for your questions. Regarding the numbers, they are included because it would be clear which outline zoning plans we were referring to. We do understand that the numbers of outline zoning plans may be updated. Well, we have the most updated numbers here at the moment, but we would say this whether there is a need to update the numbers in the schedule. We would refer to the outline zoning plans to say which areas included. It is not often the case that the areas defined in a particular outline zoning plan will be changed, so we consider that there is no need to update the numbers here in the schedule for outline zoning plans. See, this is the question that I wish to follow up on. I understand where you're coming from, but then here it is said to be all areas included in a particular outline zoning plan, and there is a number included. This is a policy for the Bureau. So I believe in previous discussions we have raised the issue of how reliable it is for us to rely on outline zoning plans. Urban planning is of course also undertaken by the government. You can have different zonings for different areas. So is it possible for the administration to say specifically the areas included in the outlined zoning plan? If you don't say all areas, instead you should say specific areas. I don't think it would be against your policy intent. In fact, it would offer you some flexibility. What do you think? Thank you, Chair. If I understand correctly, what you said earlier would allow us to say specific areas in the outline zoning plan would be set as designated areas. We can review this. But at this point in time, we still wish to rely on the outline zoning plans, and we would say designated areas are to be all areas included in the outline zoning plan. If we make out the specific areas, it may be different from what we have in mind right now, that is for all areas included in the outline zoning plan. We do not have plans at the moment to set out the specific areas to be included. In fact, we have already discussed this in such discussions. So we have talked about why amendments may be made. And when an area is deleted, it would generally be the case that only one or two buildings are left in the area that have yet to be redeveloped. So I think it is feasible for the government to set out specific areas. In fact, I'm asking a question here, I'm not just giving a comment. Does the bill preclude the government from taking a flexible approach in the sense that you can set out specific areas in outline zoning plans in future? I'm not asking you to amend the provisions now. I'm just saying if it is possible for you to designate specific areas in outline zoning plans in future. Chair, I believe this approach can be taken because Section 5 of the chapter would allow the schedule to be amended by the Secretary for Development. So you can be flexible in that regard with the setting of the content of a schedule, correct? Yes. Mr. Louis Long, I want to echo on the chairman's concern on this point. When you talk about an amendment being made, as the chairman said earlier, if the secretary is to make an amendment to the schedule, they would have the power to say specific areas in the outline zoning plans instead of all areas included in the outline zoning plans. Is it correct that the secretary would have such power?
DOJ, I thank the member for the question. Like Ms. Carmen Khan said, we adopt the concept under cap 1. That is, the list can be abolished or can be amended. So, in the future, the Secretary will enjoy much power. Within the same Gazette, the Secretary may set out new designated areas or amend the original list of designated areas. So we are empowering the Secretary to do so in accordance with Cap 1 of the law. Mr. Long, well, knowing that the Secretary will be given such a power, I have my worries. I believe the industry will welcome this in the development, from the development perspective, that is to add these OZPs into the list of designated areas. Say item 2 here is all areas included in Wan Chai OZP. If the Secretary makes a decision to remove this item 2 in the future, of course, there would be justifications given by the administration if such an amendment is to be made. I'm not questioning that the Secretary should not be given such a power to do so. A lot of preparatory work has to be carried out when an old district is redeveloped. The relevant stakeholders may refer to this list of designated areas. To make certain commercial decisions, say a developer may acquire a certain number of undivided shares until the threshold is met. And if the Secretary removes an item from the list after the threshold is met for that developer, then that developer may be left helpless. Would the administration be able to provide reassurance to relevant stakeholders so that the relevant stakeholders can manage the potential risks when making certain decisions? I'd like to take this opportunity to clarify why I asked my previous question. It is exactly in line with the question posed by Mr. Long. The existing legislation allows the Secretary for Development to have the absolute power to, through Gazetto, add or remove certain items from the list of designated areas. There is a very small chance that members of the general public would raise disputes. However, if there is any amendments to be made to the OZP, then the general public can, through the town planning ordinance, raise objections in accordance with the established mechanism. I'm not saying that the government has to do anything now. What I'm saying is that the Secretary for Development will be given a lot of power under this bill. Under the existing legislation, the relevant sectors and the public can, in accordance with established mechanism, to raise objections. Oftentimes, administration make reference to a lot of information or statistics when it decides to amend a plan. So it's not like you're going to arbitrarily make amendments to the list or OZP. Permanent Secretary, there may be concerns or worries if we remove certain OZPs from this list of designated areas. We promise here again that if we are to remove certain OZPs from this list, we will be very prudent. We will take into consideration whether by removing certain OZPs from the list, would it pose any risks or impacts on any development procedures. I think whether we decide to add or remove OZPs to the list, there should be enough discussions at the community level. Before we make the gazetto, there should be enough discussions in the community. We will consult the development panel of this council, for instance, if we are to amend the list, so that the general public will be aware of any potential changes to the list and that we can collect views from the public. Say the development panel has no objections to the amendments to the list, then we will proceed with gazetting the subsidiary legislation. It is under the government's control when the subsidiary legislation will be gazetted. As you know, we adhere to the negative vetting procedure. If needed, well, the entire council may examine or scrutinize the subsidiary legislation. So there is room, or there will be room, for the public to have a discussion about this if we are to amend the list. Say a part of the area under the OZP has been more or less redeveloped, and that it will not fall under a designated area. However, for some other parts under the same OZP may still be old and dilapidated. Like DOJ said, the administration in such circumstances have the absolute power to specify certain area under the OZP to be included in the list. This power will be given to the Secretary for Development. For some old districts which see near completion of redevelopment, they may be excluded from the designated areas within the same OZP. So we've finished Cap 545A. Now we move on to Cap 17A, Lands Tribunal Rules. We make amendments to Cap 17A because we have amended certain procedures under Cap 545. So there has to be consequential amendments to Cap 17A so that it aligns with Cap 545's amendments. We're at page 42 of the marked-up copy, part 4 of Cap 17A. We have made certain amendments to the interpretation, that is Section 78A. We're removing the interpretation for ordinance. Instead, we're adding an interpretation for CAP 545, which means the Land Compulsory Sale for Redevelopment Ordinance. Since we're adding this definition for CAP 545, we're making consequential amendments to the definition of main application by removing the term the ordinance. We're also adding another definition for purchaser, which has the meaning given by Section 2, Bracket 1 of CAP 545. For minority owners who would like to stay in their flat for another 6 months after the lot is sold, then purchaser, or the idea of purchaser, would come in. That's why we're adding this definition here. Page 43. We're adding the definition of CAP 545 above. That's why for Section 78B, where the term the ordinance is brought up, they're all going to be changed to CAP 545. We're adding Section 78CA here. Notice of no objection. When we scrutinized CAP 545, we mentioned that there is a streamlined procedure. Say, the buildings are all about 50 years of age, and all affected minority owners are traceable, and that all the minority owners have, through their legal representatives, submitted the notice of no objections, then the applicant may, through the expert, provide a report to prove that the buildings have to be redeveloped. So here, this part talks about the procedure of submitting a notice of no objection. Subsection 1. This rule applies if, in relation to the application, the respondent has no objection that the tribunal does not have to consider whether the redevelopment of a lot, the subject of the application, is justified due to the age or state of repair of the existing development on the lot under Section 4, Bracket 2A1 of CAP 545. Subsection 2. The respondent may file a notice of no objection with the registrar in respect of the lot. Subsection 3. The notice of no objection A must be 1. Substantially in accordance with Form 33A, which is a new form. 2. Filed by the respondent's legal representative within 21 days after the service of the notice of application on the respondent. So, this is about the time frame within which the party has to submit the notice of no objection. And this notice of no objection will have to be submitted through the respondent's legal representative. 3B, the notice of no objection takes effect immediately after it is filed. And C, the notice cannot be withdrawn despite Rule 27, Bracket 1. Once the notice of no objection is filed, then the applicant will not have to submit an expert report. Here it says that once the notice of no objection is filed, it cannot be withdrawn. Mr. Tony Che, I have a suggestion. Section 78CA, Bracket 1. My view is that the drafting in Chinese is kind of clumsy. I understand that the Chinese version comes from the translation of the English version. To me, the way it is drafted in Chinese is clumsy. I'm referring to Section 78CA, subsection 1 here. The English version is very clear to me. The idea is that there is no dispute about the age or stage of repair when considering whether the redevelopment should be carried out. So I think the Chinese version should be made clearer here. Say a notice of no objection is filed, but the lot has been transferred to another owner. How would such situation be handled?
Thank you. They would have to follow what we have right now. For one, we will review the drafting in Chinese to see what we can do about it. Thank you. Ms. Carmen Khan, I want to ask about brackets 3. It says, the notice of no objection must be substantially in accordance with Form 33A. Why do you say substantially? Is the form too complicated, or do you want to allow some flexibility so that the notice of no objection would only have to be substantially in accordance with Form 33A? Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Carmen Khan. We have adopted existing arrangements for Chapter 17A. In fact, you can refer to Rule 78C for notice of opposition. It says here also that it only has to be substantially in accordance with Form 33. That's why we have adopted the same expression here for notice of no objection. The contents must be there, but then the form would only have to be substantially in accordance with Form 33A. Thank you. Please turn on the microphone for the legal advisor. Thank you. Let me give some supplementary details. In Chapter 1, it provides that as long as the content is not affected, even if the documents are in different formats, it does not affect the power of such instruments. So they may have spelled it out here, but in general, even if it is not spelled out, the forms would not affect the power of the instruments. I do thank the member for raising this point, however, so that we can clarify this. Thank you. I do thank the DOJ for making such clarification. Dr. Lo Wai Kwok, I want to ask about 78CA brackets 1. I agree with Mr. Tony Tse. When you talk about notice of no objection, we only have to make clear what one does not have objection to. So I think it is very clear what one would have no objection to, and I think we can therefore make the expression less clumsy here for brackets 1. Thank you. Ms. Doreen Kong has a question on this. So for a notice of no objection, why is the respondent required to engage a legal representative? Will the administration please explain that? Thank you. So if there is an applicant that submits an application for compulsory sale under Chapter 545, the minority owner would have the power to express their objections. So the tribunal would have to make reference to the age and state of repair of the buildings when making a judgment. So the minority owners may raise objections. Even if they don't raise objections, the tribunal would have to make reference to the age and the state of repair of the buildings. So the tribunal would have to do this no matter. So basically, the applicant would have to submit a report to say that redevelopment is warranted, and the tribunal would have to consider various factors, including this, to allow compulsory sale of the building. But with the waiving that we propose of the requirement for a report or the age and state of repair of the building to be considered, if there are no objections from minority owners, the tribunal may skip some procedures in the sense that they no longer have to consider the age and state of repair of the building and go ahead with the rest of the procedures. So essentially, the minority owners would have waived some of their rights because the Lands Tribunal was supposed to consider for minority owners whether the age and state of repair of the building would warrant redevelopment, and the minority owners in not raising such objections would be waiving some of their rights. We want to make sure the minority owners are aware of their rights and they are not coerced into such decisions, so we would require them to engage legal representatives when filing the notice of no objection. Okay, now I have a question. So we want to streamline procedures with the allowing of minority owners to file notices of no objection. And if owners wish to expedite the procedures, one reason would be that they want to get the proceeds as soon as possible. But then you are making it difficult for them because they need to first engage a legal representative to file the notice of no objection. So in operation, minority owners are not forced to file the notice of no objection. And there are no penalties involved should there be such act, apparently. So you're not only asking them to sign the notice of no objection, you're asking them to engage a legal representative to, as you said, protect their rights and to confirm the notice of no objection is valid. I did understand where you're coming from. I will convey your answers to Ms. Doreen Kong, but I hope the administration to take note of what I said, because asking minority owners to engage a legal representative would be an extra burden And they may not essentially gain anything from the engagement of a legal representative. It's just for reference, thank you. Ms. Common Khan. Chair, I'm taking a different perspective here from you. We have discussed many policy issues before. I think it is important to protect the private property rights of minority owners. Because we have, with a notice of no objection, a waiver of the requirement for the applicant to submit a report on whether redevelopment of the building is warranted with reference to the building's age and state of repair. And some threshold would have to be met here with the filing of the notice of no objection. One, all owners should be identified. And two, all such owners would have to not object to the application. I do understand where the chairman is coming from, but I think it is more appropriate to have the dedicated office and have the office work with NGOs to provide more support to minority owners. As for the notice of opposition, there is no need for one to engage a legal representative because it would be beneficial to the individuals. So they would not need to engage a legal representative to file a notice of opposition, but that would not be the case for a notice of no objection. So that's why you would ask a legal representative be engaged. Please proceed. Excuse me. I can see that Mr. Louis Long has pressed a request to speak button. Mr. Louis Long, thank you. I want to ask for the engagement of the legal representative. The legal representative is supposed to explain the document or the process to the minority owner and would witness the signing of the notice of no objection as well as filing the notice of no objection, correct? Yes, Mr. Louis Leung. The legal representative would have to explain to the minority owner the contents of the notice of no objection, the powers of the notice of no objection, and we would also ask the legal representative to sign the notice of no objection. All right, thank you. Please proceed. Thank you, Chair. For brackets 4, the respondent must also serve a copy of the notice of no objection on the applicant within 3 days after the date on which the notice is filed under subrule 2. For rule 78D's amendment, we have made an amendment in the Chinese text to say a copy of the notice so as to ensure consistency between the Chinese and English versions. Please proceed. Thank you. We're now at page 45 of the marked up copy. We have amended the reference from the ordinance to chapter 545. We have also added rule 78 FA. As minority owners who would wish to occupy the property for not more than 6 months, they would have to submit an application for occupation permit. I will now read out 78 AFA.
Section C, application for further occupation. 78FA, Notice of Occupation 1. This rule applies if in relation to a lot the subject of an application under Section 3, Bracket 1 of Cap 545, the respondent wishes to continue to occupy property of the respondent on the lot for a period not exceeding 6 months after the day on which the purchaser of the lot becomes the owner of the lot. Bracket 2. For the purposes of Section 4, capital letter B of Cap 545, the respondent may file a notice of occupation with the registrar in respect of the property. Bracket 3. The notice of occupation must be A. Substantially in accordance with Form 335A, which is a new form. B. Filed before the date on which the tribunal makes an order for sale of the lot. And C. Accompanied by documents showing that the respondent has occupied the property for not less than 3 months immediately before the date of the filing of the notice of occupation. Bracket 4. The respondent must also serve a copy of the notice of occupation on the applicant in the main application within 3 days after the date on which the notice is filed under subrule bracket 2. Please carry on. We're amending the existing Form 32, as well as Form 33A and 35A. Page 46. This concerns the existing Form 32. The applicant needs to submit this form to the Land Tribunal. We're introducing facilitation measures for applications involving adjoining lots. And in these applications, we're requiring applicants to submit two pieces of information. One, the standalone redevelopment value for each of the lots concerned, which will be in the form of a valuation report. When the Lands Tribunal considers whether the applicant meets the application threshold, it would refer to the averaging calculation method. And one of the factors to be considered is the size of the lot. So we will ask applicants to submit information about the size of the lots concerned. They include the government lease, two, information about the undivided shares, and three, building plans of the lot. Page 47. We're adding the part that says copies of documents as required under Section 3, Bracket 2C of the Ordinance are attached. And these documents referred to here are information that shows the size of the lots concerned. B. We're adding subsection B here, or bracket B here, which requires the applicant to submit information about the standalone redevelopment value of each individual lot. Bracket B here says a valuation report with the following details as specified in Part 1A of Schedule 1 to the ordinance has been prepared and is attached. 1. The assessed market value of each property on the lot. 2. The following assessed market values. A. For a single lot governed by a deed of mutual covenant, the assessed market value of the lot, which takes into account the redevelopment potential of the lot on its own. And B. For two or more lots governed by a single deed of mutual covenant, the assessed market value of all the lots, which takes into account the joint redevelopment potential of the lots on their own. Please carry on. There is an asterisk next to the triangle here for applications that do not involve adjoining lots, they won't have to submit the documents mentioned just now. Therefore, an asterisk here is added that says delete whichever is inapplicable. We're adding two new forms under Cap 17A. Form 33A will be added after Form 33. As mentioned, if the affected minority owners are not opposing the applications, they may file a notice of no objection. And this will be in the form of Form 33A in accordance with Section 78CA. The heading of the form says Notice of No Objection under Land Compulsory Sale for Redevelopment Ordinance under Section 4, bracket 2, capital letter A. So such Notice of No Objection will have to be submitted in accordance with Cap 545. In the form, the following information will have to be included: name and address of applicant, the majority owner; name, address, and status of respondent, the minority owner; address and description of premises. And at the bottom part, a declaration will have to be made, which says, I or we have no objection that the tribunal does not have to consider whether the redevelopment of the lot, which is the subject of the application, is justified due to the age or state of repair of the existing development on the lot under Section 4, bracket 2A1 of the ordinance. Mr. Lewis Long. There's a declaration in Form 33A. It says, we have no objection that the tribunal does not have to consider whether the redevelopment of the lot, which is the subject of the application, is justified due to the age or state of repair of the existing development on the lot under Section 4, bracket 2A1 of the ordinance. So I understand that this will be included in Form 33A. Well, my other question is about legal representatives. By looking at this form, it seems like the respondent will sign on the form and the legal representative will submit this form on behalf of his or her client. So it's not like the legal representative will witness the signing of the form. Well, I'm not a legal expert, but I wonder if the respondent signs this form, will the solicitor or the legal representative have to witness the signing? DOJ. I thank members for the suggestions. Just now, the member read out the Chinese of the declaration of Form 33A. If you look at Cap 545, Section 4, bracket 2A1, the form is drafted in accordance with that section. If you look at page 12 of the marked up copy, under Cap 545, we drafted the declaration in accordance with Section 4, bracket 2A1. Section 78CA under Cap 17A will be enacted in accordance with this section of Cap 545. So we want to ensure the consistency between the two ordinances. You may want to adjust the wording for clarity's sake, but what Mr. Long is saying is that if we stress the importance of filing the no objection notice, would it be necessary to have a witness witnessing the signing? Well, we will think about it. Please continue. Page 50 of the marked up copy. It is the continuation of the new Form 33A. The form requires the signature of the respondent, name and number of the respondent. And down below, there is a part that says this notice is filed by bracket the name of solicitor's firm of bracket address solicitors for the said respondent on a certain date. And then the name of the solicitor's firm will have to be filled in. Address for service of the respondent will also have to be provided. This form will have to be submitted to 1. The registrar of the lands tribunal, 2. The applicant if it is a majority owner, and 3. It says please add such other persons as may be required to be served. The address for service has to be a correspondence address. It cannot be an electronic address such as an email address. Ms. Carmen Khan. I see that for name and number of the respondent, there may be some inconsistencies between the Chinese and English form. Page 50 of the marked up copy, inconsistencies between the Chinese and English versions. Please follow up on that. Thank you. Members were supposed to conclude this meeting at 12:30, but we only have very little left for the clause-by-clause scrutiny. If we're going over 12:30 p.m., well, I hope for your understanding that we should finish the clause-by-clause scrutiny today. Form 35A. Notice of Occupation. It is drafted in accordance with Section 78FA. Here, the applicant will have to fill out the application number. The heading of this form is Notice of Occupation under Land Compulsory Sale for Redevelopment Ordinance under Section 4B. Here it says I or we of bracket specify the premises as the respondent bracket the minority owner have occupied the premises for not less than 3 months immediately before the date on which this notice of occupation is filed. 2. Copies of documents that show my or our occupation of the premises for not less than 3 months immediately before the date on which this notice of occupation is filed are attached. 3. I or we wish to continue to occupy the premises for a duration of, bracket state the period, after the day on which the purchaser of the lot becomes the owner of the lot, dated this day. Then there is the signature of the respondent, name and number of the respondent, and address for service of the respondent. The form has to be submitted to 1. The registrar of the lands tribunal, 2. The applicant, bracket majority owner in the main application, 3. It says please add such other persons as may be required to be served.
Mr. Tony Tse, I have one point to make. If one wishes to continue to occupy the property, one would have to pay market rent. Should this be included in the form, such information? The administration, will you take note of this suggestion? DOJ. I also want to answer Ms. Khan's question on the inconsistency between the Chinese and English versions of name and number of the respondent. The respondent may be a natural person or a body corporate. For body corporate, they would not have a name. That is a name for a person. So in Chinese, we would have different expressions for names of people and names of body corporates, which is why we made such distinction in the Chinese version. Thank you. Ms. Carmen Khan, I would like to thank the DOJ for clarifying that. I now know respondents may be natural persons or body corporates. As long as you confirm this is the usual practice that you adopt for the Chinese version, then I have no problem with that. Because this distinction, as you may know, is not shown in the English version. I believe number would refer specifically to a company number, though. Is that correct? I would also like to echo on Mr. Tony Tse's point. For the new form, Form 35A, in order to provide more protection to minority owners, we should make sure it is made clear in the form that owner-occupiers would have to pay to the purchaser of the lot for continuous occupation after the sale of the lot. And such amount will be deducted from the proceeds for sale. I think that would be ideal. Thank you. The administration, will you take note of this suggestion? Mr. Louis Long, I would also like to clarify something. For the name and number of the respondent, what does the number refer to? Are you referring to one's identity card number, case number, or the number of the business registration certificate? We will review this because we have only copied existing forms wording for this new form, and we can review the contents of the existing forms after the meeting. All right, thank you for the clarification. If members have no other questions, I will ask the legal advisor if she would have to raise any issues. None. Thank you. We have completed clause-by-clause examination. I do not plan on commencing the scrutiny of the proposed CSAs. The next meeting will be held on 7th of June at 10:45 in the morning. And we can then review whether 2 hours would be enough to review the proposed CSAs. Thank you. Meeting adjourned.